Now, you've also expressed some frustration with quantum physicists in terms of blind spots. You just alluded to it. So regarding interpretations of quantum mechanics, let's flesh that out some more, please.
Yes. Well, the important point is that quantum mechanics only gives statistical answers to any questions as to what will happen when you make such an experiment. And you directly get the statistical answer, which is part of the world of possible answers that seems reasonable. And so quantum mechanics gives you the correct probabilistic predictions. But the real world isn't probabilistic. It's only probabilistic if you don't have all information to be sure that this book is there and that book is there. No, if you just open the cupboard, you find all books falling on the floor, and you can't predict how they will fall on the floor, except to make kind of predictions, just as in quantum mechanics, where you say, no, we don't know where this book is going, we don't know where that book is going, but we just know the probability that something happens. And this you can calculate, and this you can check against experiment. Do we get wide deviations from the probabilities predicted by quantum mechanics? So in that sense, the theory is right, but the theory gives completely wrong predictions as to say, well, where now exactly will everything come? Quantum mechanics can only give statistical predictions. And I think those predictions are totally wrong, but they are closer to the truth than anything else you can predict. So, and they're closer to the truth because in many cases you cannot make any better predictions. Think of an insurance company. The insurance company is not interested in exactly where and when you made your accident. The insurance company will just want to know how many cars are there, how many people are driving these cars, how many have alcohol in their blood, how many have done this, how many have done that. So they want a statistical answer. They don't want the explicit answers. So I think in the world of science also, quantum mechanics will give you the statistical answers and not the true answers. But to me, that means that the theory is incorrect. We should basically have a theory which, if you start with a situation where every single particle, every single atom, every single photon is exactly localized the way where it should be, or having the probabilities that it should, having the properties that it should have, without any doubt, any uncertainty, then the theory should predict explicitly where every single particle is going. Now, we don't have such a theory, and quantum mechanics is not such a theory, but eventually what I want is have a theory that gives this kind of predictions. If you knew all the initial data with infinite accuracy, with mathematical precision, then the theory gives you an explicit result that every single particle only collide in one particular way, and all the others are simply not happening. So that's the theory I want for quantum mechanics, even though I know very well that nobody will ever be able to use that property in practice. In practice, we don't know the initial states so accurately that we don't know how particles will collide, so any answer will be as good as any other. So, but then quantum mechanics is a perfect, ingenious theory that gives you exactly the right probabilities, which is what we want in practice anyway. So for practical use, it's not so meaningful to search for a theory that predicts everything with infinite prediction. But for me, searching for what such a theory look like will give me some idea about the ultimate truth, a theory that, like quantum mechanics, gives you very precise probabilities. But if you knew the initial state, it would be infinitely precise. Such a theory have my strong preference, even if we don't even know how to start building such a theory. And that's the peculiar situation right now, that even if you wanted a deterministic theory, it is very hard to design it just from scratch. We don't know enough.
So when you say quantum theory is quote-unquote totally wrong, I'm sure, firstly, some people may be thinking hidden variables. Is that what this professor is arguing for? Hidden variables have been disproved. We can get to your cellular automata approach shortly. But why would you say that it's totally wrong? because the counterargument is that it's considerably precise in its predictions and it's been verified to more digits than anything else in any other field of our knowledge.
What is wrong is that the theory doesn't ever talk about generally existing situations, which I have a probability 1 of happening and probability 0 of not happening, or any other situation is probability 0. Think of two particles in a beam like at CERN. The two particles will hit each other. And suppose we knew exactly how these two particles, how many of them will hit and how they will hit and so on, then still quantum mechanics gives you a probabilistic outcome, even though the initial state were precisely defined, then still the theory gives you a statistical answer. And that, according to my intuition, cannot be right.
Okay, so the probability distribution is not such that it's zero everywhere except at one place and gives 100.
Yes, yes.
I see.
And by the way, you wanted to ask a question about hidden variables, but what I'm talking about really is the hidden variable theory, or rather the philosophy of the hidden variable theory is exactly followed. Except when people try to make computations with hidden variables, they don't follow its own philosophy, and that's why they get contradictions which are worse than the contradictions in quantum mechanics. So they say, no, that cannot be right.
Tell me about this. What's the distinction between hidden variables as people conceptualize it and then the so-called philosophy of hidden variables? What is the philosophy of hidden variables?
Well, in principle, it agrees. That's why I call it the philosophy of the hidden variables. The hidden variable itself obeys this philosophical intuition that it should be giving infinitely perfect, infinitely precise predictions. The probabilistic outcome or distributions that we measure in our experiments comes about because we don't know well enough how to do any calculations that will give you a more precise result. It's the same like when you, in the weather forecast, you predict there will be clouds there will be rain there, but we cannot possibly predict where every single raindrop will be falling, how exactly the clouds will be shaped, and so on. Of course, we cannot do that. That's much too hard. But it doesn't mean that the meteorologist who makes this prediction doesn't try to predict as accurately as he can what the shapes of the clouds will be and so on. But as you know, of course, they're not far from getting very precise theories about that.
So there are, broadly speaking, two interpretations of the wave function. One is called psi-ontic, and then another is called psi-epistemic. And for people who have vaguely heard these terms, ontic refers to something existing in reality, and then epistemic has to do with our knowledge of it. So psi-ontic, people who believe the wave function is real, tend to be Everettians, for instance. And then psi-epistemics, I assume you would qualify as such. And then the counter-argument would be, well, what about the PBR theorem? So there are loopholes. Can you speak about these loopholes, please? And also, I would love to know your view on many worlds.
It's basically the same, that many worlds is as untrue as the other theories of quantum mechanics, where you have several realities. But the many worlds theory is the extreme logical conclusion from this hidden variable, from not from the hidden variable theory, but from the many worlds theory, that every single outcome is possible with a certain quantum probability. I'm saying, well, you would expect even a deterministic theory to give such predictions because you are not able to do every computation as accurately as you want. So even if you have a deterministic theory, then still you would only be able to make statistical predictions. So you have to take the complete world of all possible states. That's your in state, your initial state. The final state will also be a distribution of certain, of infinitely many possibilities. And your theory is better if these probability distributions look more similar to the reality. So, that's the kind of theory which one could call hidden variable theories. And I agree that that's basically the main idea, that there are variables that we cannot identify exactly today, but which happen only with certainty, never with a distribution of superposition of possibilities, but only single sharp states.
Roger Penrose is also known for saying quantum theory is wrong.
Note, I also spoke to Roger Penrose about this very topic. Link in the description.
Quantum theory as a whole is wrong. It's not Einstein was wrong. Quantum mechanics is wrong. Now, I say this very blatantly because it's a blatant topic. I mean, Einstein and Schrodinger were much more polite. They said it was incomplete. Incomplete means wrong.
Well, you're telling it like it is.
You've got to change it so it's wrong.
And I'm curious, given that you're both Nobel Prize winners who believe quantum theory is incomplete, which is how I would characterize it, just so you know, have you ever had a conversation with Penrose about this?
Yes, but very often I disagree with him, and there are basic issues. But his formulation is a bit vague as to what it exactly means. But he has many theories that I don't believe in. But my only belief is that the ultimate theory of nature, whatever it looks like, has only variables, like hidden variables, and everything that happens, happens with certainty. This happens, that does not happen, but there's nothing in between. There's never a superposition between a dead cat and a live cat, for instance. That's the famous example where you bring that you have quantum mechanics to the extreme. No, I would think that we don't know what the theory will predict, whether the cat will die, whether the cat will survive. We don't know that. That's very, very hard. But in principle, the theory should predict whether the cat will be alive or not, and the cat will not be in a superposition. That's only because our understanding today of the true laws of nature is too uncertain and too imprecise to be able to do any better than saying that the cat will have a certain probability of surviving this experiment, and we can calculate even that probability, but we don't know how to do it better than that.
So, I know we spoke briefly off air, and I want to reference something. This is a quotation from you, I believe. I hope I wrote this down correctly. My claim is that if we ever hit the true equations, there will be no superposition any longer.
Yes.
So this is what you're referring to.
That's what I'm saying, yes.
Okay, please expand on that. So why would it be that if you found the true equations, there would be no superposition?
Well, this... I still remember your first question was about why do people not believe the easy things and why do they have such more difficulty, less difficulty with let's say it again. In your first question, you...
I talked about how the more outlandish and zany the theory, the more it's accepted, at least it's cognitively easy for a physicist to not find objections with it.
The thing that people now always put in doubt is, to me, the far most obvious situation. I think that that grains of sand are particles just like planets and stars, rocks, or atoms or molecules. They're all particles and they all obey equations. And okay, the equations of the molecules and the atoms is a bit different, but basically it should be the same. That is to say, there are variables which determine what it will do next. But an atom or a molecule is much more complicated than what people think. It's not just that the molecule consists of so many atoms and then they're in a wave function and that's it. No, they are not in a wave function. There are things there which I don't know whether they are atoms or molecules, but something else. And they only obey equations that lead to certain outcomes if you know the initial state with infinite certainty. That holds for rocks, for sand, for atoms and molecules and elementary particles and photons and neutrinos, you name it all, they're all only obeying deterministic laws. I would find this the most obvious suspicion, because I can't prove it. I can only say this is my favorite view of what the scientific world ultimately will be facing, a theory of that nature. But I find it very difficult to imagine anything else, whereas all these people who come with these fantastic quantum stories, they think they can get away with much more complicated ideas without anybody questioning.
The Economist covers math, physics, philosophy, and AI in a manner that shows how different countries perceive developments and how they impact markets. They recently published a piece on China's new neutrino detector. They cover extending life via mitochondrial transplants, creating an entirely new field of medicine. But it's also not just science. They analyze culture. They analyze finance, economics, business, international affairs across every region. I'm particularly liking their new insider feature. It was just launched this month. It gives you, it gives me, a front row access to The Economist's internal editorial debates, where senior editors argue through the news with world leaders and policymakers in twice weekly long format shows. Basically, an extremely high-quality podcast. Whether it's scientific innovation or shifting global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage beyond headlines. As a Toll listener, you get a special discount. Head over to economist.com/TOE to subscribe. That's economist.com/TOE for your discount.